Hey, church family, happy Sabbath from Denise, Todd, and Katie. We hope that you're having a blessed and great day, and you've had a wonderful Sabbath so far with your church family and your family and friends. Hope that last week was a blessing for you as well. And we just want to give you a couple of quick announcements. Jennings Lake Church is back open the 16th, 11 a.m. services, Sabbath morning today. And prayer meeting is back Tuesday night, 7 p.m. We had a great group this past Tuesday. We are in Matthew chapter 26. And if you haven't had a chance to tune in, I really want to encourage you. Pastor Carl is just doing a fantastic job of breaking this down for us. We're spending a lot of time on just a few verses, and it's really just giving us great knowledge and insight and a lot of great discussion. And also, Pastor Carl has praise and prayer requests as well. So it's a great time to gather with your church family midweek and have prayer requests, praise reports, and get into God's word. And I know that you'll be blessed. So we want to encourage you. Denise sends out a little link every week that you can get in by dialing on your phone or your laptop or your tablet. And it is a blessing. So I want to encourage that. Also, please keep all of our young people in the military services in your prayers. We think of Miss Andrea, Darlene's granddaughter, I believe, is in the Naval Services, and also Harry Figueroa Jr. in the Army, and then any others that we may have that are in active duty. So keep them in your prayers every day. We also want to keep uplifting Miss Elena, as she is in Africa with her team, and they're just having a wonderful, wonderful God-filled time there. Keep them safe and well. And so with that, I believe that that's all of our announcements, and so we will get started with our singing today. We're gonna gather at the river this morning.
Shall we gather at the river where bright angels feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by?
Hope you guys are enjoying the scenes. Hopefully you can see them that Miss Denise has up on the TV. We've left Thanksgiving and Christmas and winter behind with the fireplace, and she's got some spring pictures coming up there. So hope that's as enjoyable to y'all if you can see them as we can here. All right, one of Miss Edwina's favorites, number 2.
Oh, what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Behold, what manner of love the Father has given unto us. That we should be called the sons of God. That
wrap up with, I think, a favorite of a lot of folks at Jennings Lake. I know this is one of Miss Wanda's favorites, and I know it's one of Dave Hawkins' favorites. And so Miss Denise is over here to the left of me. You just can't see her. I know she's going to be helping, and hope everybody at the house will help me out with this one. Sip after that. Thank you. All right, so we are going to be back in the book of Joshua this week, just like we were last week. Today we're going to be in Joshua chapter 6. So if you want to get your Bibles open and ready, we're going to have prayer. Father God, we just ask that you will bless us and guide us as we come to you today, as we look through your book of Joshua, Lord, in this exciting story of how you instruct him to go across and take the land which you've already given him, and what is going to happen about this great menacing fortress Jericho that is staring him straight in the eye. Send the Holy Spirit to guide us, Lord. Help us only to see and hear Jesus. It's our prayer in his name. Amen. All right, so before we start in, I want to share something with you that I looked up on the internet. Let me get that pulled right up here. And my Bible tools are loading. There we go. Okay. Now, what I want to read real quick is, in case anybody is wondering, how really big was this? Was this a small fortress? Was it a large fortress? Just how big was this structure? One of the sites that I'm looking at is called BibleStudyTools.com. And some of the archaeologists that have been there and have done extensive digs over the last 70 plus years, they've come about and they said the mound, or the tell is what they call it, of Jericho was surrounded by a great earthen rampart or embankment. So before you even get to Jericho, there's this great big earthen embankment that's around it. And on top of that, with a stone retaining wall at its base, the retaining wall was some 12 to 15 feet high. On top of this, this was a mud brick wall 6 feet thick and about 20 to 26 feet high. At the crest of the embankment was a similar mud brick wall whose base was roughly 46 feet above ground level outside the retaining wall. This is what loomed high above the Israelites as they marched around the city each day for 7 days. Humanly speaking, it was impossible for the Israelites to penetrate the impenetrable bastion of Jericho. So, as we're going to start reading, they are looking at an imposing structure that they're going to have to take. And as we read, we're going to see that they're going to take this with very unconventional methods. It says that after the seventh trip around the city on the seventh day, Scripture tells us that the wall fell flat. A more accurate rendering of the Hebrew word here would be fell beneath itself. And so this gives us kind of a mental picture of what just exactly was staring the Israelite army as they came in. So today we're going to be in Joshua chapter 6 in the land of Jericho. A great companion read to this is going to be in Patriarchs and Prophets chapter 45. After last week's little sermonette, we were talking about a fait accompli, that French word meaning that God has already given us this answer, that the outcome, you can't argue about it, it has already happened. So God has told Joshua, I've already given you this land. You guys need to go in, you need to occupy it. And so now in chapter 1 last week, if you will remember, we've crossed over the Jordan. We're now in the promised land. And the first city, the first obstacle that comes before them is this huge, impenetrable fortress called Jericho. And as I was thinking about this and studying this week and reading, Denise read something in a devotional a couple of weeks back, and it was talking about, are you counting every brick? As you look at your problems, the Jerichos that lie in front of you, are you taking it by faith that God says, this is already yours, it's already happened, I'm going to fight this battle for you? Or do you do sometimes like Todd does, and you start looking at the problem, you start looking at that fortress, and you start counting the number of bricks in it, and how am I ever going to do this? How's this ever going to happen? It humanly can't. And that's the great story that we're going to be reading today in Joshua chapter 6, that the fight is not ours, the fight is God's, and we're going to read this. Hebrews chapter 11 tells us, I believe in verse 30, that the walls came down by faith, not by what the Israelites did or did not do, but they came down by faith in what God has told them. So I want to start off in Joshua chapter 6. It goes on, it says, now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And just a real quick reading of that, you think, well, they had the gate shut and everything was locked up. But if you look further into what the historians say, that the city of Jericho wasn't just shut up, that they had the doors bolted and locked, that this fortress was so secure, and they had a water supply that was flowing into there. They had, the archaeologists have found numerous big pots full of grain that had just been harvested. So there was years of a water supply and years of a food supply that the people in Jericho could have just waited Joshua out. That through human devices, Joshua could not have taken that city. That there was no way to penetrate those walls. There was no way to get in. There was no way to breach them, to go over, to go under, to go around. That all the inhabitants had to do was just sit in there. And so verse 2 goes on to say, and the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king and the mighty men of valor. When I read that, the SDA Bible commentary talks about that, and it says that this phrase is prophetic perfect. Excuse me. Make sure I'm saying that right. Prophetic perfect. Yes, it says that when the Bible is deemed prophetic perfect, that it has already happened, that it isn't something that's going to happen, or if you go and do this, but God is already telling Joshua in verse 2 that I have given Jericho into your hand, its king and the mighty men of valor. Doesn't tell him that you've got to go and you've got to set explosives or you've got to ram this wall. He says, I've already given you this and the king and all its men of valor. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go around the city once. This you shall do for 6 days. And the seven priests shall bear seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the seventh day you shall march around the city seven times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. It shall come to pass when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him. Can you imagine that? That Joshua, this is a guy who is a great leader. He's a fierce warrior. He's not frightened by this task. But even to this veteran, you would think that he's got to think, wow, we're not going to go and attack, or we're not going to try to get some weapon that God has instructed us. That all we have to do is gather up these people like he's told us and march around it for 6 days and do nothing. And then the seventh day, we're going to do the same thing. But then something's going to happen. As you continue to read, and I encourage you to read all of chapter 6 today, God instructs Joshua. He said, what I want you to do is, because there were so many, many, many thousands and thousands of soldiers, they couldn't all have compassed around. So Bible commentary tells us that more than likely what has happened is he has picked certain warriors that represent each tribe to go in front of the priests that are going to be carrying the ark and carrying those ram's horns. So you've got your mighty warriors are going to be out in front. You've got your priests with the ark and the ram's horns right behind them. And you've got some more priests behind those priests. And then back behind what the Bible calls in the rear guard, you've got more of the army of Israel that's going to follow them around. And so for the first 6 days, God has instructed them to just march around and to be silent, to not utter a word, to don't speak a thing. The only thing that's going on is the blowing of those ram's horns. And so you're going to do this one time each day for the first 6 days. But then on the seventh day, you guys are then going to do the exact same thing. But on the appointed time, when you make that full seventh circle and the ram's horn is blown, you're going to shout out at that moment in time, and God is going to bring those walls down and give you victory. As you go on, fast forward to verse 20, it says, so the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpet, and it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. Can you imagine that? What a great time we're going to have when we get to heaven and we can talk to Joshua and those priests and those mighty men of valor who were there, who can tell us with their own eyes what they saw when they shouted and those horns were blew, how God supernaturally caused those walls to tumble down. It says, then the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. Archaeologists tell us that the walls, the bricks, they crumbled in such a manner that it made almost like ramparts, that the soldiers could just walk right up over those fallen bricks and enter into the city and have direct access to everything. The wall fell down flat. Can you imagine what a wonderful thing? God had already told him in verse 2, I've already given you this. This is yours. You don't have to go and do anything except just do what I have told you. One of the commentaries that I read this week, and I want to read this with you. The silence for the 6 days wasn't for the inhabitants of Jericho. The silence for the 6 days was for the Israelites. I want to read to you something that I wrote down this week. It says, the 6 days of silence impressed upon their minds the need of God. Delay impresses upon us our need of God and teaches us to trust him. God was using those 6 days of silence for the Israelites as they marched around, as everybody watched what was going on, for them to contemplate that God has told us this is what's going to happen, that this was making them trust in God, for them to depend upon God. Keep silent and wait on God's blessings. I think that's great advice for us in today's times, right? That sometimes I want to start counting the bricks, and I want to see, how can I attack this problem? How can I make this happen? Instead of marching around my Jericho 6 times and being silent and being in prayer and waiting for God to reveal to me what he's going to do about this situation. And then on the seventh day, act and do what God is telling me. Bible commentary from the Seventh-day Adventist says this. When he talks about to compass the city, they made the circuit once each day. The solemn, silent procession struck terror to the hearts of the watchers from the walls of the doomed city. Can you imagine how odd they must have thought that here we are, we're ready for the attack. What are they doing? They're marching around in silence. They're not doing anything. They recalled how God miraculously wrought for his people in opening up a passage for them through the Red Sea and more recently through the Jordan. And they tried to fathom the mystery of these strange proceedings. You know, they had already saw firsthand. They'd heard the stories of how mighty God is and what the blessings he's already done for his children. And so now they're up on these walls and they're soldiers. They're watching God's soldiers, the Israelites, walk around and they can't help but wonder what's going to happen. We already know God's power. But the lesson was rather for the Israelites. God commanded that these solemn ceremonies be extended over 7 days before he brought down the city walls. He wished to give the Israelites time to develop faith. Isn't that a wonderful thought that maybe sometimes God doesn't answer our requests immediately because he's wanting us to wait on him. He's wanting to develop our faith. So as we go through our different struggles and trials, that maybe each struggle that follows the last will be a little stronger in our faith because of what God has done for that last one. It says, but God commanded that these solemn ceremonies be extended over the 7 days. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down, Hebrews 11:30. The people needed to fully understand that the battle was not theirs, but the Lord's. He could do great things for them if they cooperated with him. Doesn't that same principle hold true for us today? Faith is simply the acceptance of God's program and full cooperation with his plan. This is the kind of faith that will accomplish as great of things for us as it did for the ancients. I thought that that was just wonderful commentary about how God can build and use our faith just like he did for the Israelites, as he had them march around in silence for 6 days. But on the seventh, God, through his instructions to them, they followed what God had told them, and God brought those walls down, just like he said he already did in verse 2 of chapter 6. So I just want to encourage you this week that whatever Jericho that you might be facing down, as you have now entered into your promised land, as we talked last week, What new problem is facing you? What Jericho is lying there in front of you? Take it to God in prayer. Trust it in God that whether it's 6 days or 7 days or immediately or 6 months, that God is working out a plan for whatever's troubling you. Just be patient and trust in him. Denise and I and Katie wish everybody a happy and blessed Sabbath. We love everybody. We hope that you're well and safe. And I just want to encourage everyone to please stay vigilant during these times. The vaccines are being rolled out. That's going to be a help. But please keep your mask on. Keep your social distance. Wash your hands and stay safe. We love you. We'll talk to you soon. Have a blessed Sabbath. Bye.